tonight that we take back our community.
Right on. Yes. Right on.
Thank you all for joining us this evening. I'd like to introduce our very first speaker, who we all know as a mover and shaker in our community. Not only does she talk the talk, but she walks the walk. So without further ado, I present to you Miss Tarina Vinay Williams.
Okay, you guys know that I don't do public speaking, but I'm doing it because this is a passion of mine. And it'll, you'll get me up on the stage when it's something that I have to speak about. So, brothers, how y'all doing?
Fine.
Sisters, are y'all all right?
Yeah.
All right. The minority community has been taken for granted by the Democratic Party and Jay Jacobs. Mm-hmm. Our community has been shut out of jobs, business opportunities, while being unrepresented in the police department. And get this, we pay the highest property taxes while people who live in mansions pay less. Democrats are now expected to follow like sheep behind Jay Jacobs and along with his puppets to support someone who's completely unqualified to be county exec.
Say it again, Tarina.
In today's Newsday, Laura Curran has been expelled from the Democratic caucus since October because she broke with her Democratic colleagues and voted with the Republicans of the majority. She can't even work well with her own Democratic caucus. Tonight, we must say no to party Jay Jacobs and his puppets. We want to take back our community.
Yes!
We want to demand justice. We want affordable housing. We want to stop gentrification in our community. We want to lower our property taxes. We want more jobs, and we want, and what else do we want? And we especially want to be represented in our police department.
Yes. Yes.
Tonight we come together to form an independent democratic movement to empower ourselves and to help empower the rest of Nassau County. Mm. Right now, we want all of you to register and to become committee people. We want you to volunteer. We need to take back our community, and it starts tonight.
Yes!
Okay. I got a half, very hard task to do, but I'm gonna do it. First, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about myself. I'm a former Board of Elections worker. I'm a former deputy leader of the First Legislative District. I founded the Greater Uniondale Democratic Club. I'm also the former master member of the Nassau County Caucus of Black Democrats. So I have a lot of knowledge about the democratic process. And taking our community back is a serious issue. It starts with grassroots. And I just first want to talk about grass. Do everybody know the most important vegetable on this planet? Anybody know?
Grass.
Everything starts off as grass, no matter what it is. It starts off in the root. And to build a foundation that's strong, we have to start at the root, the foundation. That's us. We the people. We the people have to be the first fence of defense.
Right.
It's not about who leads us, it's who we push to lead us. And they must listen to us. And the first thing we have to do is take back our districts.
Yes.
Yeah.
And how do we take back our districts? What we have to do to take our districts is know what our district actually is. In Nassau County, there's levels of government. And the first thing we have to understand is our congressional district. That's our federal. And if we don't represent the federal, Donald Trump will continue to do what he's doing. And the reason why I'm coming to you now is because we don't want to just do a campaign for today. We want to empower ourselves for tomorrow. And the only way to empower ourselves tomorrow is to do grassroots issues. And some of the first things to do is know what an election district is. Everybody knows what an election district is? Raise your hand if you do. If you don't, I'm going to tell you anyway. Election district consists of blocks. Maybe 15 blocks makes an election district. In each one across the United States. In other places in the United States, they call them precincts. But those precincts are electric districts that we all live in, no matter who lives there. Whether they're Latino, Black, White, Asian, you live in an electronic district. And there's a representative in each district. Do everybody know their leader of their district? That's bad. That means you're not in touch with the electrical socket at all. You can't get juice if you don't stick it in.
Come on.
Right. Don't believe that you're going to get something to work if you don't stick it in. You got to stick it in to get the juice, to be a connection. And if you're not connected, you can't expect to get anything out of the subject itself. You can't hear the music without being plugged in. So we have to first get plugged in. And once you're plugged into the socket, you can get some juice and you can flow. Okay? So my job tonight is to ask people to become a part of the system. And this system starts off simple and plain. How many of us have nosy people on our block? Come on now, y'all know we all got some nosy people on your block who knows everything. Miss Johnson knows everything is going on. She knows who got fired, who's messing with who, who's doing what. Am I right or wrong? Okay, tonight I'm asking some of you guys to become block captains, to become that nosy lady on the block, that nosy guy on the block, because that nosy person, same person you ask, what do you think we should do in this election? Am I right or wrong? You go and ask that nosy person, who you think is the candidate we should support? So I'm asking tonight for some of you guys to become block captains. Remember I said election district is about 10 or 12 blocks. So if we had one captain in that district, he would be able to not only inform us what's on the district, but also be able to bring back information to an elected official. Anybody's with me so far?
Yes.
Okay, if you're not with me, let me know now, because I'll back up and come back. Because I want you to be plugged in with me into the system. If you plug out, it won't work. And this is why we are where we are. We have to be totally plugged into the system. And the way to be totally plugged in, I heard somebody earlier mention Jay Jacobs, right? Don't get quiet now. Don't get quiet now. The only way to control that man is to become a committee man.
That's right.
Because the committee elects and elects and relects. But right now, the Democratic Party, and I'm not knocking the party because I'm a Democrat, it's weak. The reason why it's weak is because it has what we call paper members. They sign the sheet, but they're not there physically. They're not in the community. They're not connected. They don't know what's going on. They don't know what's happening on your block. How can they go back and tell somebody about the pothole if they're not connected? Paper can't be connected. It's not electrical. It doesn't have that power of ability to connect. So paper doesn't make it. But you stick your finger in that socket, I bet you'll feel something. Because you have electricity in you.
Right.
You have kinetic. And the only way we can make this happen is be kinetic. And the only way to be kinetic, be touching, is that you are part of the system. That you are a committee person making major decisions for what's going on. Now, we all live in a democratic village, right?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay, so you would think this is a perfect place, right?
Right.
But it's not. You know why? Because your committee people are not connected. They're not telling the boss what's going on, what needs to happen. He's telling them what to do, how to do it, where to do it at. Because he's not connected. When last time you seen Jay walk in the village of Hempstead?
Never!
Say that again.
Only when he's scouting out land.
He doesn't do anything. So, I don't want to take much of your time. I just wanted to bring this to your attention because the job we want to do tonight is calling for action. And actually what we're calling for is for you to get connected to the system.
Yes.
And we want everybody to receive a form today. Did everybody have a sign-in sheet? Who did you get a sign-in sheet?
Did everybody get a sign-in sheet?
Now we're going to check your name now and call you up if you didn't show. So don't think you'll get away with this. All right? But I need everyone to fill a form out and get a part of the system. Okay?
Okay.
Yes.
Is that good?
Yes.
Now I'm going to bring you somebody now who's a Long Island son. Mm-hmm. He's from Long Island. He's born, bred, raised here, and he preaches here. Ooh. Okay? He's from the AME Church here, Zion. Mm-hmm. Zion AME Church.
Jackson.
All right. I know y'all know. He's dedicated to power and empowering people.
That is true.
Okay?
Yes,
he is what they call a liberated preacher. He's not the old-fashioned, he's going to give you what you need to get. Y'all know what I mean, a hop.
All right, Reverend.
All right, Deacon. And, I just want to get this out. He truly believes that the gospel of Jesus Christ is the liberation for every human being on this planet. I want to bring to you, without a doubt, Brother Malcolm J. Boyd. Good man.
Great job, Matt.
Thank you.
Well, for the sake of good measure, my beloved brothers and sisters, I'm so honored to greet all of you this evening. And though the food has been splendid, whomever hath prepared it have the hands that have been blessed by God indeed. But we're not here to eat, nor are we here to play or to dream. But we are here this evening to act. Act upon what, you may ask? We are here to place our integrity, not just in our minds, not just as something we think about or think through, but we are here to enlist the integrity of our feet and the integrity of our voices, demanding that we will be heard. And what do we say?
Amen.
Amen is one thing to say.
Amen.
But I want to talk briefly, as brief as a preacher can tonight, about the problem of maintaining the status quo. Stanley Hoffenstein's great book from 1928 titled Poems in Praise of Practically Nothing. Hoffenstein used that very famous line, come weal, come woe, my status is always quo. How problematic that is, when for many all we are attempting to do is not to thrive, but only seeking to maintain whatever position we may have. Not so much lofty positions, but we are just trying as a people and as a community to do whatever we have to do, to shake whatever hands we have to shake, just to keep our peace of the right now.
Wow, wow.
Don't agitate the gravel.
Wow.
Don't ask questions. Keep your peace, and for God's sakes, Reverend, keep your mouth shut.
Wow.
We have grown comfortable as a community in chaos. We believe somehow that if we don't upset the right people, somehow or another, the right things just may fall from their table enough.
Wow.
And if we keep gathering the crumbs from under their table long enough, maybe we'll have a decent meal to feed our children. Come weal or come woe, My status is always quo. The status quo in politics has been problematic in American history almost from the very beginning.
That's right.
If we were to go back to 1849, the United States of America was at that time teetering upon moral and social decay. John Calhoun of South Carolina and others began to rumble and grumble in the Senate and the House of Representatives, wondering, asking the question, should the South secede from the Union? They raised this question because they were interested in maintaining their status quo of keeping millions of exiled Africans in America enslaved that they may be the ones to gain. This is American history, like it or not.
That's right.
So the political bosses at the time were trying their best to figure out, how do we squash these hard-nosed, blistering words of these representatives and senators from the American South? So the Whig Party, you ever heard of them? The Whig Party decided that the best way to deal with all of this is to put up someone who would appease the sensibilities of the liberal Northerner while also not upsetting the financial gains of those Southern men in power. And I said men because that's who were in power. So what did they do? They go over to the bluegrass states of Kentucky, and they find the wealthiest, most famous person in the country at the time. This person who they selected to be the one to run and to lead the nation had never held political office. He was incredibly wealthy. He was a, are you all still with me?
Yes.
He was, I'm a black preacher, I gotta hear something every now and then. I'm gonna need to help me now. I'm giving you the best I got, baby. And what they did, they found the most famous person in the country at the time.
Yeah.
He was famous because he was a war hero. Everyone knew him. He was recognized. He was wealthy. He never had to lift a finger. If he did not have to, he had servants. He had slaves. You name it, he had it.
Yeah.
All right now.
And it was a party that decided, you know, this man could be the best person for us. So what did they do? They selected, they pinpointed, they identified Zachary Taylor to be the president of the United States of America. Not to free anyone. Mm-hmm. Not to liberate anyone. But simply to maintain the status quo. Mm-hmm. Come will, come woe. Mm-hmm. My status,
yes, sir,
is always quo.
Wow.
And because history has a very good way of repeating itself. Another party did the same thing a few years ago. Recently, actually this past summer. They found someone very wealthy, very famous, also never held political office.
But he wasn't a war hero.
Yet, for some reason, indeed, for some reason, this man seemed to fit the bill for what many Americans wanted. Now, why do you say that they supported 45 to become president of the United States? I can't tell you why, but I have some assumptions. Because we are a very racist society. And I think that political parties, both Republican and Democrat, can also perpetuate considerable racism, especially in minority communities. what we are experiencing around here. I'll get to it in a moment. I'm walking my way there. What you see here in the country is not only did we elect 45 to suit our racist agenda, but we also elected 45 so that our comforts for those who are in power would not be upset. We didn't want anyone, well, some didn't want someone to rock the boat as much as the previous administration did. Affordable health care, equal health care, access to health care for all people, that's too much for us to bear. People healthy, that's not maintaining the status quo. People living in fair and affordable housing, that's not maintaining the status quo. Okay. People being employed, being policed by people who look like them, that's not maintaining the status quo. All right. Come weal, come woe, says they. My status must also always be quo. And if we were to bring this conversation much closer, I would say that our biggest problem in this village, in this community, and in this county is that for the most part, most of us are just as interested in maintaining the status quo as much as those political bosses are at keeping us in our places. It is the party bosses, as Jay Jacobs and others, who've done a great job in many respects keeping the lid on some of us.
Say it again!
But also, they could not do it by themselves.
That's right.
What happened to the fight that emanates from a grassroots people? What happened to the courage that kept people like Harriet Tubman and Sojourner Truth and Martin Luther King bound together and committed? Where is it? It's somewhere hiding behind a job.
Preach, Reverend.
Hiding behind a position. Hiding behind a false sense of power. And excuse me, what kind of power do you think they're gonna just give you? Well, two more minutes, I'll sit down. As I like to say all the time, if you wanna hear the rest of this, you gotta come to Jackson Sunday. There you go. And that is why it's so very important not to allow your voice to lose its integrity, not to allow your commitment to be something that can be thrown into the trash can. That's why it's so very important not to maintain the status quo. But what is the status quo around here? Not even 40 of our young people are graduating from the high school. 40%. What is the status quo? That we are engaged now in a building project in which most people who live in this village couldn't afford to rent a one-bedroom unit anyway. That's what you call gentrification. Anytime it's built and the people in the community can't afford it, it's not built for you. But try to fight that fight, and you'll run into party bosses who are the real leaders of many of our municipalities. I can say it because I work for God. And no one is in my pocket, and if you want to be, you got to pay up a whole lot more money than you have.
Aren't you tired of maintaining the status quo?
Yes.
Aren't you tired of the same old, same old?
Yes.
Aren't you sick and tired of being sick and tired?
Yes.
Aren't you tired of making bricks without straw?
Yes.
Well, then do something about
it.
Get on the road. Speak up. And deserve and demand that your voice and your vote be heard.
Yes.
It takes a lot of courage. If I were in North Carolina, they would say it takes high religion to step out of the line that everybody else is in. It takes courage to do that. It takes courage to step out and to do what needs to be done for the people in whom you desire to serve. Whether there is party backing or not.
Yeah.
George, we're with you.
Yes!
Yeah. Yes!
We're with you because we understand how much courage it takes to say enough is enough. And I would go as far as to say that if this room got on one accord, and if this room got to the place where they were tired of maintaining the status quo, tired of people who don't live in our communities running our communities, tired of people calling the shots regarding your quality of life and how you live and how your children live, and you've never seen them walking the streets around here.
That's right.
I know I'm right. But that's why groups like this are so very important. That's why groups like the 100 Coalition are very important. Bipartisan, not in anyone's pockets, seeking to address and to speak to the necessary things in our community that otherwise will come to you after the decisions have been made. I think we are too smart of a community.
Yes.
I think we are too intelligent as a community.
Yes.
To allow party politics to determine what we deem as best and right for ourselves, for our community, for our children, and most importantly, for our future.
Yes.
I close now. Every preacher has a close. I remember hearing a story, my mother telling me a story about those famous New York blackouts of the 1970s. She told me a story about the New York blackout of the 1970s.
77, I was right on the
mark. I wasn't born somewhere around that time. About one of those blackouts. The city was clutched in utter darkness. If we were to borrow the words from James Weldon Johnson, they say that it was darker than 100 midnights down in a cypress swamp. That's dark. But one area of New York City was not surrounded by utter darkness. Someone looked out and saw the Statue of Liberty in the middle of Liberty Island. And on top of the Statue of Liberty, they noticed that her light was still shining bright. In the middle of a blackout, her light was still shining bright. Well, even after the lights were back on, this baffled, it dumbfounded those who had observed that sight a few nights before. So the engineers put on diving suits and they swam down under the Statue of Liberty to figure out how in the world the Statue of Liberty in the middle of New York Harbor could still be shining bright in the middle of a New York blackout. It baffled them. Well, the diver came up and said, well, I have something to report to you. I know why the Statue of Liberty was still shining in the middle of a blackout. And everyone said, well, what? How? How did this happen?
And the diver said, well, the Statue of Liberty in the middle of New York Harbor is actually plugged into New Jersey. Let me say this to all of you. We may be living in Nassau County with powerful political bosses. We may be living in a community that's marginalized and disinherited in every sense of the word, but we are not plugged in to degradation. We are not plugged in to political bosses. We have a higher power source, and that higher power source comes when community gets together and works together and fights together. Then when people get together with one mind and one voice demanding that it's time to make a change, right now is the right time, come weal or woe, my status is not quo.
Let's hear it again from the Reverend Malcolm A. Burr. Lorena, the next time, in order, you know, when you put me up here, don't make sure you put, don't put anybody up. That is my pastor. It's my honor this afternoon to introduce our comptroller. The comptroller, I don't have to stand here and tell you what he does. But let me say that I've had the privilege of working with the comptroller for 6 years. And let me also say, George, welcome to Hempstead. In this very same room, these are the people who elect me as mayor of this village for 16
years. All right.
Dealing with some good people. Let me say, I'm not going to go into all this, what he does in terms of looking over the budget, because that's his job. But I will say he's a man with a vision.
Yeah.
A vision with, he put together the MWBE, mm-hmm. and he's not going to quit until we have 100% participation in minorities. Yeah. He's a man with a vision that is second to none. Let me say again, he has done a real good job. I've had a chance to work with him for 6 years, and I have, and I, in fact, I love to go to work each and every day. Not too many people can say that, but I really like to go to work each and every day to work with this man. It's my honor to present to you the 13th elected comptroller of this county, the Honorable George Merrill.
Reverend Bird, I gotta come and take some lessons. I have heard nobody anywhere more dynamic and inspirational like as Reverend Bird. Let's give him a round of applause. He was very good too, wasn't he? Matt, thank you. You were great as well. And Jim, it's been a privilege to work with you in the controller's office for 6 years. We've been troublemakers, actually. The controller's office has never been like we've made it to be. Everybody hates us.
Not everybody.
Everybody hates us. As you know, I was in private industry for 35 years before I came into government. And what I have discovered in 7 years, going on 8 that I've been there, that there is a political establishment, a political elite in Nassau County.
Right.
And you cannot tell the difference whether it's the Republican elite or the Democratic elite. The political bosses and the puppets are in it for themselves.
Right.
Yeah. Right. Say it again.
Right. It's not about public service.
Right.
Remarkable to say.
Right.
It's about staying in power, taking care of their friends at the expense of everybody else.
Right.
And that is the truth. Because I've seen it on the Republican side and I've seen it on the Democratic side.
Right.
It's the same thing. And everybody else is excluded. Mm-hmm. They're not sitting at the table. None of you here are sitting at the table.
No. Right. It's true.
And as Reverend Byrd said, we're all waiting for those crumbs to fall off the table.
Yeah. Right.
For our opportunity.
Right.
For a job. Mm-hmm. For affordable housing. Mm-hmm. Whatever it might be. For justice. Fair treatment. Equality. In housing, in every aspect, in your tax assessment.
Right.
There is absolutely no justice. If you use a politically connected law firm, you're gonna get a significant and disproportionate reduction in your property tax assessment.
Mm-hmm.
And you know who are those people that can afford to use those expensive, politically connected law firms? They're the people that have those mansions.
That's right.
And you know who picks up the tab for any and every tax break that they're given? The middle class and the minorities.
Right.
End up subsidizing the mansions. Is that just?
No.
No.
No. No. No.
Ladies and gentlemen, that cannot continue.
Right.
And you are the only ones that can put an end to it. If you want to, if you're willing to stand up for your rights, for fairness in our communities, you're not gonna get it any other way. I can assure you of that.
Right.
The political establishment will fight.
Right.
We would want to retain power, and they would want all the benefits that come with power. And somebody ultimately has to pay. And it's the minority communities, it's the middle class communities that have been paying and will continue to pay.
Yeah. Right.
And that's what I've seen as controller for the past 7 years. And you can say, well, what, haven't you done anything about it? The controller is not empowered to make policy changes, to pass laws. I stood up many times, and that's why I've been labeled as the leading critic of this administration, because I stood up to them, and many contracts that they wanted to give to their political connected friends did not occur, did not happen. I pointed out back in 2011, when we did an audit, that the tax assessment system was unfair and would shift the tax burden from the wealthy to the middle income and minority communities. And that's exactly what happened. Middle class and lower income communities, according to Newsday a month ago, has paid over $1.7 billion. You've all in this room have contributed to subsidizing those mansions. Is that fair?
No.
Can you afford to do it?
No.
We've also pointed out that our minority communities in Nassau County now are approaching 40% of our total residents. 40%. And yet if you look at the jobs in Nassau County, who's holding those jobs? Less than 10% are minorities. Our police department, as was pointed out, less than 5% in the police department.
are African Americans.
Mm.
We looked at the business opportunities that are being given to minorities and women-owned businesses. And there was a law in the book since 2002 that 16% of those business opportunities go to minority and women-owned firms. We discovered 3 years ago that less than 8% was going to minority and business-owned firms.
Mm.
And most of those minority firms weren't even real minority firms.
Right. Wow. Wow.
Listen.
So this government that we have, it's not your government. And it doesn't matter whether it's a Republican administration run by Joe Mandello or a Democratic administration run by Jay Jacobs. Because they inevitably and always nominate puppets. They don't want the best people that are independent. They want a puppet that they can tell what to do.
That's right.
When to do it, so they can keep that puppet. Thank you. You know, exactly. You know, do you want this to continue?
No. No.
Well, if you don't come out and vote,
right.
You know, it is going to continue.
Right.
I can assure you it's going to continue.
Right.
And we'll never get another chance like we have right now at this upcoming election.
That's right.
To take our government back.
Right.
It never happened again. As Reverend Byrd said, you know, maybe I'm crazy, maybe I'm brave. I don't know which it is. But I know it is hard. The political system closes in on itself and takes care of itself.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
It's like, you know, it's like a foreign body in our system, in our body, that, you know, it's going to fight it because it wants to retain, to destroy it because it wants to retain control.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so how can you say, you can ask, you know, that how can we do this? You know, if the political establishment is so powerful, I can tell you, we have the power and the numbers in this room to do it.
Yes.
And let me tell you what it takes. Okay, let me tell you what it takes. If we have 100 people in this room, and I think we're about there, if everybody brings 100 Democrats to vote on primary day, that will be 10,000 votes. It's going to be enough to win.
Right.
It's going to be enough to win. History tells us, we know the number of voters that come out to vote on primaries. They're not very high.
Nope.
No. Not at all.
So if you sign up today and commit to bring your neighbors, 100 people, it's not a big number, each one of you. Some will bring more. You know, and we're reaching out to in the Hispanic community. We're reaching out in the South Asian community. We can do it, and
right.
We can do it with the people in this room.
It's not
difficult to do. And it's your responsibility to take back your government.
Right.
Yes.
To demand justice.
Right.
You cannot, you know, and if you don't want to do it, it's not going to happen. You know, I stand here and I'm willing to commit and stand up for what is right. That's why I came into public service from the private sector, to be a public service, to serve the community, not to serve the party bosses. And I refuse to do that, and I will continue to refuse to do that. So this is the opportunity. Please, you know, take the opportunity to empower yourselves, empower your communities, and provide a better future for yourselves, your children, and grandchildren. You won't have another opportunity for a long, long time,
right,
like we have today.
Right.
Thank you all for coming. Let's organize and let's get this done. It's very doable. Each one of you, can you bring 100 people to vote?
I can bring 100.
We can do it.
with
the people in this room. But we're going to do much, much better because we have a tremendous outreach effort in all the minority communities. And then we're going to get our share of all the other Democrats that are going to come out to vote. But we're not going to win with just those Democrats on a random basis, expecting that they're going to come out and support us. We're going to lose. But we're going to get enough. But if we have your commitment in this room to bring 50, 100 votes on primary day, September the 12th, we are going to win. And it's going to change your lives. I guarantee you it's going to change your lives, you know, in terms of housing, affordable housing, in terms of jobs, in terms of business opportunities. Let's make it happen.
Yes!
Give it up for the next county executive.
You mean, we gotta make it happen.